Hey, good morning, City Church. Are you ready to praise the Lord today? Everybody who's sitting down better be standing up. It's time to praise Jesus. I got a scripture for you today that's so powerful. It's in Matthew 4, and it's up on the front there. Matthew 5, sorry, 13 through 16. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people hide or people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that you may see the good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Woo, that's good. So I want to see some lights out there this morning, glowing big and bright for us up here. Thank you, Jesus. Here we go.
What does it mean to be saved? Isn't it more than just a prayer to pray? More than just a way to heaven? What does it mean to be His? To be born in His likeness? Know that we have a purpose. To be salt! To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world. Let the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so.
Let the
redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so.
Oh, that the church,
oh, that the church would arise. Oh, that we would see with Jesus' eyes, we could show the world heaven. Show what it means to be His, to be formed in His likeness. Show them they have a purpose.
To be salt
and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world.
To be salt.
To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so.
Let the redeemed.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so.
I am redeemed.
I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed.
Where to be salt and light?
To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world. To be salt and light in the world, in the world. To be salt and light in the world.
To be salt.
To be salt and light in the world, in the world, in the world, in the world, in the world.
Rise up.
Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Rise up, rise up.
Say so.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so.
I am redeemed.
I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I am redeemed.
Oh, anybody glad about it?
In the world, in the world. To be soft and light in the world. To be soft. salt and light in the world, to be salt and light.
Here we go.
To be salt and light in the world, in the world, in the world, in the world, in the world.
Rise up.
Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Rise up, rise up.
Say so.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so.
Come on, give him some praise this morning. He deserves everything you got.
has proven his great love for us. We will praise him with our lives.
We proclaim
and proclaim our love for him.
Proclaim our love for him.
And proclaim our love for him.
You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, even when
you never stop working.
He made miracle works, our promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Way maker, cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never waymaker. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Cause you are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are.
Sing it.
That is who you are.
Tell him.
That is who you are. That is who you are.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Glory.
Glory, God.
You brought heaven down. was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, our King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name.
Before you are raised. powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
What a powerful name.
What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Yes. What a wonderful name it is. Shut up.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. What a wonderful name. What a wonderful name. Yes, Lord. The name of Jesus. Oh, what a wonderful name today. Hallelujah. What a wonderful name. As we prepare for the deposits, as we prepare our hearts for the deposits, children, you guys are dismissed. You guys have a wonderful time enjoying Woo-hoo! Service there. Amen. But as we prepare our hearts and minds and bodies for deposit, the song that we just sang, two songs ago, one song ago, it says this: You are here touching every heart. You are here healing every heart. You are here turning lives around. And you are here mending hearts. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper. You see, today is that day that some of us needed God to deposit something in our hearts, to change our hearts, to change our minds. That's why I show up here on Sunday mornings. You see that? Because I'm here with a group of believers, understanding that God said he would deposit something in my life. So as we prepare our hearts with our monetary gains, the monies that we have, as we deposit these monetary gains, it's doing the same things. You see, the money that you and I deposit here at City Church allows God's word to continue to fulfill his promises here. Lives are being changed. Hearts are being mended. Jobs are being gotten here. Why? Because the presence of God is here right now. Amen? You see, when we come here to service, he said, I bring heaven down to earth. Do you know heaven is here right now? Amen? Heaven is here. So that's the deposit that you and I are getting right now. But God also requires you and I to deposit something too, physically. So I'm going to say it again to our Facebook friends all over who are watching us now. You see, this is our time that we could give and continue to change and heal hearts here at City Church. You see, City Church is all about doing God's work. We are kingdom builders here. We're not religious here. We are here to build the kingdom of God. Every penny, every nickel, every dime goes toward that process of healing mind, bodies, and souls here. Amen? You see, the work is being done here. That's why I love coming to City Church, because I get to see it every day in people's lives here. 36,000 people came through this church a year ago. 36,000 people came through here a year ago. You see, this ain't nothing to play with. So as we continue to build God's kingdom, you see, God likes a cheerful giver. So I encourage each and every woman, man, and child who had the ability to give to continue to reach out and change lives here. To build God's kingdom, not on religious teachings or beliefs, but once again, to build God's kingdom, to link up here with City Church. You see, money has no color. It does its job. That's through the healing of Christ. Heavenly Father, we thank you to each and every man, woman, and child who has a heart to give. To our givers who are online right now, understand this, that your giving is changing lives here 1,000 miles away. I'm going to say it again. 36,000 people have come through this church here through your giving and your believing and trusting God that he will fulfill and change their lives. Their lives are being changed through the courses that are being taught here, through the classes that are being offered here, through the free health care that's being offered here, through the showers and haircuts that are being offered here at City Church in Fairfield, California. Hallelujah, Jesus, you are a miracle worker here. So I'm going to continue to encourage, again, each and every man and woman and child who are able and have a willing heart to link here with City Church and continue to build God's kingdom. Amen.
Thank you.
So I understand that today is a big football day. Am I right? I have to be told that because I'm not really a football fan. In fact, I had to ask who is playing, and I'm told Kansas City and Philadelphia. Am I right? All right, so how many are voting for Kansas today? All right. How many are voting for Philadelphia? Well, I was going to pray for the minority, and it's kind of divided half and half, so I'm not praying for any team today. So there, that's the way you have it. So how about this? How about we pray that those that stayed home because of the football game, their team loses? How about if we pray that, right? All right, okay, so all right. So let's, on a serious note, let's pray this morning for Maria LT, Pastor LT's wife. She's battling, we haven't seen her for weeks because she's been battling a problem with her knee, and now it has gone into a problem with her wrist. And I believe that we as a congregation of priests before the Lord, that's what we've been teaching on, that we can lift her up this morning and ask God to divinely touch her body and bring about a much needed healing. Can we do that?
Yes.
All right. So Father, right now we lift up Maria. Lord, she's at home. You see why? Because she's in pain right now. And there's something happening within her body. But Lord, you know all about it because you are the one that created us. You are the one that formed us in our mother's womb. You are the one that knew us before we were even formed in our mother's womb. You know all about us. There's nothing in us and about us that is hid from you. And Lord, right now I pray that you will touch her by your Holy Spirit, that you will quicken her body, and that you will bring about divine healing to her. Father, that you will reduce this pain and take it away. Lord, that you will make what is wrong right, what is broken healed, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen. All right, so we're going to jump in this morning, and we're going to be talking about the origin of faith. The origin of faith. That is true to the message. That title is true. I like to think of little more clever titles, but that's the best I could do with being true to the topic. The origin of faith. Where does faith come from? Have you ever asked yourself that? Where does faith come from? Now, I know that a lot of churches, and if you've been around church for any length of time, you have had to have heard at least a dozen messages on faith. But no one seems to tell us where faith comes from. Where does faith come from? So that's what I'm going to deal with today, all right? So we're going to look real quickly at Hebrews chapter 10, and we're looking at verse 38 and verse 39. Now, this is in the Passion Bible, and it is only the Passion Bible, that translation, that pulls the word out that I'm looking for. Other translations do not, but the Passion does, because the word my is found translated in the Aramaic and in the Septuagint. And so now work with me. Here we go. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 38 and 39 says this. It says, "And he, God, also says, my righteous ones will live by my faith." My righteous ones will live by my faith. Now, in some of the other translations, it will say the righteous ones will live by their faith. But I believe that's a mistranslation. And the proper translation is they will live by my faith. Now, God's faith is a perfect faith. There's nothing half done with God, right? God's faith is a perfect faith. So he says they will live by my faith. All right? And then he says, but if fear holds them back, my soul is not content with them. If fear holds them back, my soul is not content with them. All right, now again, going back to the original translation in the Greek, where it says, but if fear holds them back, the original wording is this, to cower in fear. So those that cower in fear, my soul is not content with them. In other words, God is saying, those that live in fear, I'm not happy with them. I'm not happy with them because there's no reason for them to live in fear, because they'll be living by my faith, which has the absence of all fear. All right, you with me? Okay, then in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6 says this. It says, and without faith living within us, it would be impossible to please God. For we come to God in faith, knowing that He is real and that He rewards the faith of those who passionately seek Him. Okay, let's break it down. I'm going to read it one more time. And without faith living within us, it would be impossible to please God. So the absence of faith means it's impossible to please God. Anything that has to do with our relationship with God is based on faith, all right? For we come to God in faith, knowing that He is, and that He rewards the faith of those who passionately seek Him. In other words, God always rewards faith. He never ignores faith. Faith is the element that moves God. All right, so there's three takeaways that I'm going to give you real quick, and these are not points. They're just quick takeaways. One, Paul says that it's his faith. Keep that in mind. It's his faith. And because it's his faith, that without that faith, it is impossible then to please Him. That has to be an element within us. Without it, it's impossible to please Him. And He rewards those who seek Him, not just seek Him, but seek Him with faith. So when I'm seeking God, I'm believing that God is going to reward me as I seek Him. I believe that God answers my prayers as I seek Him. I believe that element of faith, again, causes God to move in my life. Now I'm going to give you three quick things. Faith comes, the origin of faith simply comes by getting close. All right, Romans chapter 10, verse 17 says, consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. That's how faith comes. Faith comes through hearing the message. And some translations say, and that by the word of God, hearing the message, that by the word of God, in the Passion it says, and through the word of Christ, which is the word of God, that's how faith comes. So let me illustrate it this way. So let's say that you're a little boy or a little girl, and you're at the swimming pool, the public swimming pool. When I grew up, we had a swimming pool that was open to the public that was round. It was a round pool, and it gradually went deeper, deeper, deeper. And when I reached a certain age, my mother would allow us kids to go into the pool without her direct supervision. And they had lifeguards. And I remember you could go in and you couldn't go past the buoy line unless you were a certain age, because that's when it got deep and it went over your head. And I remember that I was always intimidated by the water, because I felt like I wanted to get close to the buoy line, but I didn't want to go beyond it because I thought I might not be able to swim all the way back and I would drown. Now, so as a child, I had faith. Water somewhat scared me. So now picture, you're a little child and you're at the swimming pool, and a gentleman walks up. Now this is before we had people that you have to watch out for, right? This is going back a generation where neighbors and they could discipline you, and we didn't have all the restrictions we have today. So let's say this gentleman walks up to you, and he says to you, you're standing there at the edge of the pool, and he says to you, what's your name? And you go, my name's Scotty. And he goes, Scotty, I want you to jump and I'm going to catch you. Now, I'm telling you, in a split second, I could be looking at him and think, no, I ain't doing that because I'm scared to jump, number one, and I don't know that I believe you to catch me because there's no foundation, there's no basis of faith. So there's the complete absence of faith when it comes to that. You see, you and I, we can talk faith, we can profess faith, but unless there's a foundation for faith, unless there's a basis for faith, you don't have it. So I'm going to say no to that guy. Now, I'm still playing around and stuff like that, and my dad comes up, and he swims up to the edge of the pool, and my dad says, Scotty, jump, and I'll catch you. Well, now I'm thinking, I'm going to jump because I believe my dad's ability to catch me. Why? Because there's relationship there. I know my dad. I know that my dad is trustworthy and true to his word. I've not caught him lying to me. And there's a foundation there for faith. So I'm going to jump. And sure enough, my dad catches me and we have fun all the rest of the day. I, of course, get severely sunburned and spend the rest of the week with a sunburn. So let's go back to faith comes by hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ in Romans chapter 10. What is happening in that verse? What is Paul trying to tell us in that verse? Basically, it is this, that when you come to the Lord, when you give your life to the Lord, when you say, I am going to follow Christ, that is a starting point for you. But there's not much faith there other than you've had an encounter with Jesus Christ. Something has touched your heart that you know is profoundly miraculous, and you don't know how it happened, but you know something's got a hold of you, and you answer and say, yes, I will follow you. But now you're following Jesus, but there's no foundation for faith other than that encounter. So you really have no faith. What happens is that, as Paul said in the book of Romans, the letter to the church at Rome, what he says is this. He says that faith will come as you're beginning to hear the message of what Christ says. Faith begins to be built because it creates a foundation for faith to grow. The reason why many Christians do not have faith is because they're never in the Word. It is this book that builds faith. It's not great messages. It's not seeing a healing service by a named evangelist. That does nothing to build faith. It comes through a direct relationship with Jesus Christ, and it's built by His Word. That's the we use the foundation to build faith. Faith is built upon relationship. All right, let me illustrate it this way. I love the people that I work with on a day-to-day basis, our staff. I love them. I think they're the greatest people on the face of the earth. Oh. And with one exception. So I love our staff. But here's the thing. You see, when I first became acquainted with them, I didn't trust them at all. I had no faith in them, because I didn't know them. But as we've worked together and we see each other every day, I have complete trust in them. I know, for instance, let me tell you, I'll let you in on a little secret, and you'll see that I'm proven right. I have absolutely faith in Richard, who's in our sound booth right now. And I know that whatever I ask, and he says, okay, I'll get it done, I walk away with absolute faith, knowing he's going to do it. In fact, I'll prove it to you. Next week, we're going to have two sets of cameras on both sides of this screen. We're going to be running three screens next week.
Well, come on! We believe you. We believe you.
2 weeks, we're going to have big screens on each side. All right, 2 weeks. I just wanted to do that to him just to make sure that he was publicly... He has to do it now. He can't find an excuse, right? All right, but I have faith because I know him, and he's done things before where he's kept his word, and I know him, and because of the relationship, faith is built to the extent that there is absolutely no lack of distrust anywhere in me when it comes to Richard and the other people that are part of our staff. Because their word is their bond. And what they say they will do, they will by golly get it done, and it will happen. So faith is built on relationship. Ask yourself, what kind of a relationship do you have with God? What is the depth of your relationship? What kind of a relationship do you have with this book? You know, some people, when they get to heaven, they're going to be really embarrassed. I feel really sorry for them. Have you ever been to a party and a social event where you're introduced to somebody and they assume you already know them and you really don't know who they are? And you kind of make up excuses. They go, hey, you know, yeah, remember me? We met back at such and such. You remember me, right? And you kind of lie and go, yeah, I remember you. But you're trying to think. You're so desperate to put it in God. Where was it I met you? And your mind is racing. You're going, oh, my God, please don't ask me a question. I'll be so embarrassed. That's how some people are going to be when they get to heaven. They're going to be standing in heaven, and one of the Bible greats are going to walk up to you and say, Obadiah is going to come up to you, and you're going to go, who are you? And he's going, my name's Obadiah, and you're going to say, really? And you're going to shake my hand, and he's probably Southern, I don't know, Obadiah, and he goes, surely you've read my book, haven't you? And you're going to realize you don't even know where Obadiah is. And you're going to go, yeah, I remember. I read that book. And he goes, do you remember chapter 3 where it really went down? And you're going to go, that was a great chapter. I remember that. You're going to lie right in heaven because you don't even know who Obadiah is. Malachi is going to come up to you and go, good to meet you. My name's Malachi. Surely you read my book. It's the last book in the Old Testament. I bet you remember chapter 3. It's the chapter everybody uses when they take a deposit. It's the chapter on giving. Pressed down, shaken together, running over, right? And you're going to go, yeah, I remember that one. Yeah, I remember that because when Pastor Bill took deposit, I remember he quoted that one once or twice. So I remember that. And then Malachi's going to go, but did you see what I put in chapter 2? No, I just remember what Pastor Bill said on when he took the deposit. What was in chapter 2? I didn't read that one. And you're going to be embarrassed. A lot of people are just going to be embarrassed. The shame is that you have God's word at your disposal 24/7. To not be in it and to not know it is a choice you make. You see, the early church didn't have what we have. In fact, I think that if the early church could stand right now here and see the way that we treat this book, they would be appalled. There are Christians in China right now. I watched a video of a home church because they meet underground. They meet in homes secretly. And I watched a video about 2 weeks ago of two boxes being delivered to that home church. Two boxes of Bibles, and I believe they were paperback Gideon Bibles, I'm not sure. But I watched those people, when they opened those boxes, go absolutely berserk. I mean, they ripped those boxes open, and they weren't taken from each other, but they could not get their hands on that Bible quick enough. I mean, they were dancing and shouting and hugging and crying and starting to look through it. A Bible that you and I take for granted. In fact, some of you, if you brought it today, and that's not even necessary, we make it so easy, we put it on the screen for you. But if you brought it, some of you are going to go home and throw it right on the table in the living room and pick it up again next Sunday and make sure you wipe the dust off it so nobody will know that it's been sitting there all week. Shame on you. All right, I'm done beating you up for a minute. But that's why there is no faith. There's no faith because faith comes from this book. Now, faith also comes from messages that are quoting this book and about this book, but the reality is faith comes from this book. If you want to supersize your faith, get in this book. Now, there's something else that happens, and you actually will see this in Corinthians, where Paul talks about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit. And in Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 9, Paul says this about one of the gifts. Now, their gift of revelation, gift of knowledge, gift of healing, and he goes through all of these gifts. But one of the gifts, it says, he says, and to another, the same Spirit gives the gift of faith. So faith, there is this gifting of faith. What kind of faith is that? What is that faith like? That faith is the faith that allowed Jesus to feed 5,000 people with a few fish and a few loaves of bread. A miraculous feeding, unbelievable. They kept passing fish out and it kept multiplying. They kept passing bread out and it kept multiplying. It was that kind of faith that allowed Joshua in the battle to, he needed more sunlight, he needed more day, and he prayed and commanded the sun to stand still, and it stood still and increased the length of the day so that they could complete and win the battle. It was that kind of faith that Jesus said to Lazarus, who had been dead, Lazarus, come out of the tomb. Jesus knew he would not be dead and stay dead, come out of the tomb, and he comes out and he appears dead, risen back to life. It's that kind of faith. It's that kind of faith where Elijah said to Ahab, You have blasphemed God. You have caused this entire nation to walk away from God. And God said, I'm going to stop the rain. And for 3 years, he prayed, stop the rain. And it brought famine on the land until there was great repentance and this duel with the prophets of Baal. And then he calls down fire from heaven and smokes them. It's that kind of faith. That is a gift of faith. Now, let me tie it together. We talked about faith comes by hearing, and that by this word. That's how faith comes. But let me give you something else that happens. Faith comes by hearing. Faith comes when I read what God does and what God can do and what God has done. That's faith happens right there. It's just like my dad saying, Scotty, jump, I'll catch you. It's the same thing. I knew my dad, I knew what he is capable of, and I knew he never lied. Now, he never asked me to do that before, but I was willing to take the plunge because I knew my dad. As you read this book, you develop a deep, deep relationship with God, and it happens supernaturally. I've said this 100 times. This book is alive and living. It's not just black and white print. It's not just paper and leather. It is a living book. And as you read it, something begins to happen in your spirit. There is a divine connection with God in your spirit. So when you're reading this book, and then all of a sudden you come across something and it touches you deeply and it ignites something in you. It breathes something in you. And all of a sudden you walk away going, I believe that for my life. I believe that God is going to do that for my life. You see, faith came by hearing, and that by the word of God. Now, there's something else that happens through this book, and it's a dimension of the Holy Spirit, where there is built in you miraculous faith to believe for the absolute impossible. The gift of faith is often delivered through this book. Yesterday I had to go for a training, and it's a training I have to go to every couple of years, and I hate it. In fact, the year I know that I have to go to the training, I dread it for 11 months until I come to that month that I have to go. And I just hate it. I can't tell you why I hate it. It intimidates me to death, and I hate it. In fact, I was scheduled to go three times. I canceled out three times. I found an excuse not to go. Well, it's raining. I'm not going. And it was raining again. I'm not going. And finally, I just said, I can't make any more excuses. I just have to go and get it behind me. And so I am just, I had to get up early in the morning. Man, I feel sick. I don't want to go. God, why do I have to do this? And I'm having a moment, right? And I'm scared. I'm scared. It scares me. And the drive there scares me. I mean, I see that last block coming. I'm going, oh, I got to turn in that driveway and go. So lo and behold, what am I teaching on? I'm teaching on faith. Something just kind of whispered to me and said, why are you so worked up over this? Perfect peace. The person whose mind is on Christ has perfect peace. That's what the Bible says, whose mind is on him has perfect peace. So I started to pray, and I said, God, I am going to believe you to help me get through this. I'm going to believe you to help me pass. I'm going to believe you to just protect, guide me, and just wrap your loving arms around me to where I don't have to be so doggone intimidated. Because here's what I realized, and we looked at this in the first verse we looked at. What I realized is that God, but if fear holds them back, my soul is not content, or my soul is not pleased with them. I realized that in my moment of fear, I realized that God was basically saying, I really am unpleased with you. I'm unpleased with you because you don't believe that I can get you through this. And I'm unpleased with that. In fact, I'll just put it another way. I believe God says this. I believe God says, you insult me when you don't believe me. It's insulting to me. If I walked up to you and I said right now, if I said, I've got $5 in my pocket, and Stephen, I'm going to give it to you. And if he said, no, I don't think you do. I don't think you will. I don't think you can. I just don't know. Let me see the five first. I want to make sure it's real. I would say to Stephen, let me go find somebody else to give the $5 to, because I don't like your attitude. You don't believe I can do this. You don't believe I would do this for you. Then forget you. How about you? You see, I'm going to find somebody that's going to go, okay, I'll take it. That's where, when we have unbelief, we insult God. We insult the creator of everything. The creator of you. The creator of you formed you, made you. The creator of you, and you're going to tell God, I just don't know if you can do it. And yet you sit here. In bodily form, you sit here. And yet this whole galaxy operates. Planets revolving around, gravity form, clouds dispersing rain, sea that does not go over its border. All of this happens on a day-to-day basis right in front of your eyes. You are living it. And yet we're going to tell God, I don't know if you can do that. That insults God. How insulting. It's sometimes I wonder that God just doesn't go and knock us out. So when he says, when you cower in fear, my soul is not pleased with you. What God is saying is, you insult me when you do that. And when I was driving to this appointment, I felt that I insulted God. I insulted him. I allowed myself to get worked up in my own mind, not thinking for one second that all I've got to do is ask God to pull it all together and just help me, which, by the way, he did. He helped me, and by the way, I did pass. But I should have known he would do that before I ever left this property to go there. I insulted him. To which I had to repent for insulting God. Let me give you one last point, and that is this. No, actually, I'm going to give you two. Let's go to Mark chapter 9. Mark chapter 9. This is an interesting story. Mark chapter 9. It's the only time, to my knowledge, that you'll find something like this in the Bible. Mark chapter 9, and I'm looking at verse 21 through 24. So, actually, I'm going to start at verse 20. So the disciples come to this demon-possessed child. And verse 20, so they brought him to Jesus. So they prayed for this child, and the demon would not come out. So they bring the child to Jesus, and as soon as the demon saw him, it threw the boy into convulsions, and it fell to the ground, rolling around and foaming at the mouth. And Jesus turned to the Father and asked, how long has your son been tormented like this? We don't know how old the boy was, but he's called a child, so he must have been pre-adolescent. And the Father says, since childhood, he replied, it tries over and over to kill him by throwing him into the fire or water. But please, if you're able to do something, anything, have compassion on us and help us. Well, the Father has enough faith to come to Jesus. But you can see that there's a little bit of absence of faith when he said, if. He said, if you're able to do something, if you're able to do something, have compassion on us and help us. If you're able. I'm here. I'm willing to give this a try, but if you're able. Well, Jesus apparently picked up on it. And Jesus said to him, what do you mean if? What do you mean if? There is no if with God. What do you mean if I'm able, would I do it? If. You're here. And you're asking me to do something, but you're going to tell me if you can do it. You see, now I'm insulting Jesus. If I don't believe he can do it, why am I coming to ask him to do it? If. Then Jesus said, if you are able to believe, all things are possible to the believer. I wonder how many things we don't get in our life because we simply don't believe. I wonder how many things we're missing the opportunity. We're missing the blessing. We're missing the fulfillment of a dream. I wonder how much we miss simply because we don't believe. I think one day we're going to get to heaven and God's going to show us a warehouse of all the blessings we could have had if we only believed. He's going to say, you see all that? I gave that to you when you prayed, when you asked me, I gave it to you, but you just didn't believe. So here it sits and waits until you believe. When the father heard this, the boy's father cried out in tears, saying, I do believe, Lord, but help my unbelief. I do believe, but there's this part of me where unbelief resides. Help my unbelief. And what happens is Jesus immediately says to the deaf, dumb spirit, I command you to come out and never come into him again. And that demon left. Jesus honored him, honored his request. Because what? Because he was honest and transparent enough to say, I do believe, but there's a little part of me that I'm having a hard time. Help my unbelief. And I believed at that moment, Jesus helped his unbelief and healed his child. You cannot kid God. Let's go back to the pool. My dad says, Scotty, jump. I got you, dude. I got you, man. Come on, jump, jump, jump. Come on, come on. And I say to my dad, I believe you, but I don't think I'm going to. That's a contradiction. I believe you, but I'm not going to jump. That's a contradiction. Because if I believed, I would jump. If I believed, that would be like Peter when Jesus comes walking on the water and Peter says to Jesus, is that you? And Jesus said, it's me. And Peter says, bid me to come to you. And Jesus said, well, come on out of the boat and come walk with me. If Jesus would have said, no, I know I can, but I'm going to choose to stay in the boat. That would be a contradiction because he just asked Jesus to bid him. Now he's going to choose to stay in the boat. But if going back to my dad, I go, Dad, I believe you, but I'm going to run and I'm going to jump. Let me try it again. At some point, my dad's going to see I believe, but there's an element of doubt that's haunting me, right? So he then is going to do something to help me. Instead of standing there, he's going to come right here and he's going to say, take my hand and now jump with me. And I'm going to jump. Well, then the next time he says jump, I don't need his hand anymore. I'm just going to run and jump. When you're honest with God, God, I believe you, but there's this area of doubt I can't seem to get around. I'm not mature enough to believe you 100%. I've not seen enough of you to be that at that place. Help my unbelief. I believe at that point God helps you with your faith. And the truth is we all get there at some point. Don't kid yourself. It's easy for me to believe God for some things because I've seen God come through over and over and over and over again throughout my life. But there are some obstacles that I've not faced yet in life. that I would like to say I believe God, but I can't say I can't say that for sure because I've not experienced it. A health crisis that brings you near death. I've never experienced that. I believe God will be there. I believe God will touch me. I believe that, but I haven't experienced it yet. But what if I do experience that and I say, God, I believe you, but help my unbelief? It's at that point that God comes through what I believe we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, the gift of faith. And he gifts it to you so that you believe for the impossible, and then he does it. But it comes through honesty. Let me give you one last point. Sometimes you can piggyback on other people's faith. I'm going to give you two stories real quick. First one is in 2 Kings chapter 4, 1 through 7. And I'm actually going to read this one to you. This is Elisha. I lost Kings. 2 Kings chapter 4. And we're looking at verse 1 through 4. It says this. It says, the wife of a man from the company of the prophets cried out to Elisha, your servant, my husband, is dead, and you know that he revered the Lord, but now his creditor is coming to take my two boys as his slaves. That's the way it was done back then. When you borrowed money and you couldn't pay it back, they would come and take something of yours in lieu of payment. And if you didn't have anything for them to take in lieu of payment, what they would do is take your children as their slaves until you paid the debt off, and they would give you your kids back. But the kids stood in to be payment then for your debt, okay? So that's what happened to her. She's obviously a widow. Her husband had some debt, and the creditor came and took her two boys, or was coming to take her two boys as slaves. And Elijah replied to her, how can I help you? Tell me what you have in your house. And she says, your servant has nothing. Well, that answers why the creditor is coming to take the kids, because she had nothing. Your servant has nothing there at all, she said, except a little oil, a little bit of oil. Elijah said, go around and ask all your neighbors for empty jars. Don't ask for just a few. Then go inside, shut the door behind you and your sons, and pour oil into all the jars. And as each is filled, put one aside. Put it aside. So she left him and afterward shut the door behind her and her sons. And they brought the jars to her, and she kept pouring. And when all the jars were full, she said to her son, bring me another one. But he replied, there's not a jar left. The oil stopped flowing when he said that. So she went and told the man of God and said, and he said, go and sell the oil, pay your debts, and you and your sons can live on what is left. She's broke. She has nothing but this little jar of oil. And she's asking Elijah for help. The creditor is coming to take her two boys. And he says, go to all your neighbors and borrow all of the vessels you can, as many as you can get. Go get every jar, Tupperware, everything, anything you can get. Just get as much as you can and bring it to your house. And she does that. And then he says, take that oil, that little bit of oil you got, and begin to pour it in all of the vessels. It never ran out. It didn't run out until every jar, every container was filled with oil. And then when she said, bring me another jar, bring me something, her boy says to her, there is no more. That's all I have. And at that moment, the oil stopped. Did she have faith for that? She is being obedient without faith. She did not know that the oil would keep pouring because Elijah didn't tell her that. He said, go and get the vessels, the containers, and start pouring your oil into them. He did not say that the oil would keep replenishing itself until you filled it. He never told her that. She is being obedient to the voice of a prophet. But what's happening is she's piggybacking on his faith. That is Elisha. In 1 Kings, you have Elijah. Elijah has called famine on the land, 3 years of famine. He's being watered by a brook, and God is causing the ravens to bring him food. And the brook dries up, and God said, go to this town. I've got a widow who's going to take care of you. He goes, and it's a woman with her son. Pretty much the same type of story. And he says to the widow when he gets there, could you bring me a little bit of water? And she goes to get him the water. And while she's going, he says, oh, and bring me a piece of bread back with you. And she says to him, I've got enough flour and oil to make me and my son our last meal, and we're going to die. We're starving to death. That's all I got is a little oil and a little flour. I'm going to make us a little bread and some water, and we're going to die. And Elijah says to her, okay, but bring me the bread first. Then feed yourself. And she does that. She's obedient. She does that. And then when she goes back to feed her son and herself, again, she pours the oil and the flour, and it never runs out. And she feeds her son, and Elijah till the famine is ended. What did she do? She piggybacked on his faith. Sometimes you're going to come across something in your life that's going to set you back a bunch of steps. In God's love for you, He will bring somebody alongside of you that has more faith than you have. Never, ever reject that. And sometimes you have to say to that individual, will you pray with me about this? Because I'm having a hard time, but I can believe you and your faith, and I'm going to piggyback on your faith. I'm piggybacking on your faith. I need your faith. God will all... When we pray as a congregation, we prayed for Maria. If I went and singled people out and said, do you believe that God's going to heal Maria? Now, I know in church, I know what the right thing to say is. Oh, yeah, absolutely. But God's looking at your heart. Now, be honest to your heart. Do you believe God's going to heal Maria? You probably go, no, I can't believe for that. Okay, let me ask you, do you believe God's going to heal Maria? Well, I do, but help my unbelief. God's healed me of some pretty serious sicknesses. I know He can, but help my unbelief. Okay, well, let's go over here. Do you believe God's going to heal Maria? Absolutely I do, man. I know God can do healing like that. I've experienced a few myself. I believe God's going to heal her right now. When we corporately pray, what are we doing? We're exercising our faith. But where there's a lack of faith, we're piggybacking on other people's faith to believe for the miraculous. That's what makes corporate prayer so powerful. So powerful before heaven is because in this room, there are people that have absolute faith. And man, I'm going to join them in prayer. because where I may lack, they don't. I read a story written by Dr. Cho, and he was friends with Oral Robert. And Oral Robert is known to be a man of great faith. And Dr. Cho didn't have that kind of faith. But he said, I went to this meeting with Oral Robert in his office, and there was an individual who had been in the war, and they had amputated his leg. I'm not sure where, but part of his leg was gone. And the man came to visit Oral Roberts, and Oral Roberts said, I'm going to pray that God's going to restore your leg. And the story goes that Oral Roberts laid hands on his leg and started praying, leg grow, leg grow, leg grow. And this went on for about an hour, leg grow. Now Oral Roberts is in a sweat. He's pouring sweat. Leg grow. I command you, grow leg. And there are guests in the room, not just Dr. Cho, but other people are in the room watching him and praying with him. And after about an hour, they're going, man, I just don't know if this is going to happen. We respect him and we respect his faith. But maybe we ought to go tap him on the shoulder and say, Brother Oral, you know, maybe God will make it grow later, or when he goes to heaven, he'll grow, or you know, we come up with some of that stuff. But nobody had the courage to do it because he's so intent, and he's getting grow leg. I said grow leg, leg grow. He just won't stop. Nope. So they don't want to interrupt him. They're like afraid. And after an hour or so, to their amazement, they stood and they watched a man's leg grow from a stump into a full leg and foot. Now, sometimes you got to piggyback on somebody else's faith. Because I'll tell you, I don't have faith like that necessarily, but when I spot somebody that does, I want to pray with them. Because where my faith comes up short, theirs doesn't. You see, their faith didn't come up short because he wasn't going to stop until that leg grew. I believe he'd have been there all week saying, leg grow. He wasn't going to stop until the leg grew because he had absolute faith that leg is going to grow. Before I stop praying, that leg will grow. And it did. So my encouragement to you is if you're going to walk this walk, you cannot do it without faith in your life, and you cannot do it without faith growing in you. It is absolutely impossible, because in the absence of faith, the devil will throw something at you that you cannot deal with. You need to develop a relationship with this book so that faith begins to grow in you, because it's a relationship with God that builds that faith. And something happens. Something also happens supernatural, because God will impart through this book supernatural faith where you don't have it. Worship team is coming. As we close, take a moment and ask God, what is in my life that I am not believing you for? It's kind of like that warehouse when you get to heaven and you see all the things that God was giving you, but you just never exercise faith to receive it, and it just sits in the warehouse. God, what is in my warehouse? There's a warehouse there with your name on it, with my name on it. What's in my warehouse that you have not given me because there's no faith for it? What can I have in my life if I just believe God to do it? what things would change in my life if I believed God to bring about the change. What things could I overcome in life if I believed Him to give me the strength to overcome? See, you can have an addiction, and we can give you all the tools to deal with it. And you can manage for a while, but eventually it will probably get the best of you. But when you believe God to free you from addiction, that's a whole different story right there. That's a whole different story. When you believe God to free you from addiction, there's freedom immediately, and it's 100%. Deborah used to smoke a lot. Salem cigarettes. Only cool people smoke Salem. But it was affecting her breathing, and she wanted to sing for God. And one night she said, God, we weren't married at the time. She said, God, I want to sing for you, but smoking's affecting my ability to sin. Would you take the smoking away from me? He did that night, never touched another cigarette. No nicotine patches, no, none of that. Just woke up and did not have a desire to touch another cigarette. That's faith. Absolute freedom immediately. That's faith. See, God wants to do that for some of you. You just have to start believing and praying. Let this book build faith in you so that you can believe and get the things that are in your warehouse. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship Your holy name. And sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the worship Your holy name.
worldly things to our faith.
Worse than you. Sometimes you gotta pay your dues. So don't worry, just push on through.